Good morning, my Ephesians family. We are so blessed that God has brought us to another Sunday. Let us worship and praise our great God, our mighty God, our holy God, our magnificent God, our everything, because he is good and because he deserves it. Lift up your voice, O ye people, and bless the Lord on this morning. Father, we thank you for this Sunday. We thank you for keeping us this far. We would not have made it without you. So God, we are blessed and we are thankful and we are grateful. So God, we pray that as we are here, you are with us. You are with us and you are working through us in the mighty name of Jesus. Let's go ahead and read Psalm 105, and it says this: Oh, give thanks to the Lord, call upon his name, make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him, sing praises to him, speak of all his wonders. Glory in his holy name. Let the heart of those who seek the Lord be glad. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his face continually. Remember his wonders which he has done, his marvels and the judgments uttered about his mouth. What this scripture is telling us, it's telling us not only to remember, but to spread the good news of Jesus Christ. So go and tell the world how good, how mighty, and how magnificent our great Lord is. Come on and worship with us. Lord, you are good.
God some praise for his faithfulness towards us, for his loving kindness, for his mercy endures forever. Listen, you ought to just give God praise that his mercy endures forever. I'm so glad that God's mercy didn't run out on me at the age of 18, because I wouldn't be standing here right now. But if you know God's mercy endures forever and ever and ever, and he put it this way to try to describe the way that he even loves us. He says that it's his loving kindness. It's because of the Lord's loving kindness that we are not consumed, and we are so grateful that's why we say he is good. And I'm just grateful this morning that I'm grateful this morning that again, I want to say to you, don't drive down here, not just yet. We got a few of our volunteers who are here with us, and I can't tell you how happy I am to see their faces in the sanctuary. Those of you who are at home right now, they sitting in here, a few of them in here, and they see all the number of seats in here that's empty. But when you stand in here week after week, I am grateful that by God's grace, he has allowed for me to be able to pay attention to this camera and not be distracted. But I am so grateful to see every single one of y'all faces this morning. It's like Christmas in June right now, y'all. Y'all don't know. I can't stop smiling. I feel like a kid in a candy store just to see a few of our faithful faces here at service with us this morning. And we say that God is good because we see life through the lens of Holy Scripture. And I want to say to you, if you're watching right now, you may be saying, well, how is it that God is good? We believe Romans 8:28, that God causes all things to work together for the good. And you may be saying, well, preacher, you help me understand how God causes all things to work together for the good. Well, let me just say that in the midst of this pandemic, God has actually drawn our church closer together than further apart without being in the building. You hear what I'm saying? And so much so that I want to show you all a few pictures that from yesterday. We had a few of members of our church who came to help us with beautifying our landscaping at our church yesterday. You get a chance to see a few of them that they have up there. Sister Bennett helping us out. And there's Reverend Bennett helping us out with cutting some grass. And we got some of the kids out there. Mr. Rosenberg, you see there, who were helping us out remove some weeds. And there's Tony and his sister Justina helping us get rid of some weeds and laying some new mulch down. And so many others that you see there helping us beautify our space. And I'm so grateful, most importantly, to say a huge thank you to all of the volunteers. I want to say a special thank you to Brother Augustus Green, who helped us out in such a huge way with getting the mulch and everything together for us to be able to beautify the facilities, the space that we have here at EMBC. Let me say something to you, those of you who have been part of the Ephesians family. When you come back, I pray to God that your eyes be open, that God has blessed us with a lot, and with a lot comes a lot of responsibility. And so we have bushes to trim and everything. So when we come back together next week, by God's grace, you're going to see the new, improved, refinished Ephesians Missionary Baptist Church. And so we're so grateful for all of those volunteers who came out and took out their time to be here with us. And then today we want to celebrate a few of our graduates. We got one picture that we want to celebrate, and that's Miss Sydney Smith, who graduated from the 8th grade. And so can we give God praise for her? I want to say to all of our graduates, we are so proud of every single one of you, even those of you who have finished college. I know of two others that I just want to mention that I know off the top of my head. And for the rest of you, parents, shame on you that you didn't send those pictures here. But my niece, Miss Sade Gaines, who graduated from Hamilton High School. And also Miss Morgan Page, who I know graduated from St. Marcus. And is going on to high school, and we're so grateful for all of our graduates. And I want to say a huge thank you also to our youth and teen leaders who they went out to actually connect with some of our teens throughout this pandemic just to show some love to them, that we appreciate them. And so I'm so grateful for our teen and children volunteers who went to connect with our teens and seniors who have graduated high school. I have a couple of quick announcements. One is that on July 11th, say with me, July 11th, I told you here at EMBC, we stick to our mission. We win the loss to follow Jesus Christ. We build believers to spiritual maturity. And most importantly, we serve humanity. And so I want to invite you to join us on July 11th from 10:30 a.m. until 12:30 p.m. as we will meet at the Garden Homes Park, which is at the intersection of 26th and Atkinson. We're going to go there along with Northwestside CDC. And several other churches from around that area to clean up the park there, along with the neighboring blocks that are there, and to love on the people there. Listen, come out with us and let's serve our community. Y'all on board with us to do this? And we ask you to please visit embcmilwaukee.org so this way we can have a count of the number of people that we'll have there. So bring your rakes, bring your shovels, bring your gloves, bring your mask, and most importantly, bring the love of Jesus Christ with you, as we're going to love on our friends who live in that neighborhood, to let them know that we love them and we care for them. And then I'm very excited that next week, Sunday, everybody say with me, next Sunday. Come on, if you believe it, you're excited about next Sunday, say with me, say next Sunday. Next Sunday at 11 a.m., we will resume our in-person gathering of our worship service. Will you give God praise for that? Amen. Amen. And so we want to let you know, sir and ma'am, that we would like for you, hear me closely, because this is extremely important, even the people who are in here. We want you to go to embcmilwaukee.org. You will see it says worship service there on our website. And what we would like for you to do is we would like for you, is after you visit the EMBC website, you will scroll down and you'll see it says events. When you see events, what you're going to do is you're going to, you'll see there the in-person service is listed there. And what you're going to do is you're going to click on that where it says in-person service. When you click on that, you're going to click where it says sign up. After you click on sign up, you're going to enter in, you need to enter in the name of every single person from your household who is coming to church with you. Say it with me. Say every single person who comes with me to church, I must fill in their name there every single week. I'm saying this to you, and I'm asking you, sir, ma'am, to please abide by these instructions, because what we will be doing is we will be keeping track of every single person who comes here for our worship service, because we want to adhere to the guidelines by the city of Milwaukee and the CDC that as we gather together, if for some reason we should have, and we say it's a big if because we're going to be praying, that in the event something should happen where we have someone who is here worshiping with us and they do test positive, we want to be able to connect with every single person who was here as we gather here to worship our great God. So I'm asking you, sir, ma'am, please go onto our website to register. Right now, because our city is in phase three of its reopening program, that what will happen is that we can only seat 25% of our occupancy in our sanctuary. And so one of the ways to be able to help us to make sure that we don't exceed the seating capacity is we need every single person to go on our website, including your children. We need you, because your child's going to sit in a seat and your child counts as a person. We need you to make sure that you go on our website and enter the name of every single person, every single, if your baby's in a car seat, put their name on the website. And we need you to do this. I know some of you all are saying, well, Pastor, I get it. But see, the reason I'm saying that is because I know some of you all aren't getting it. And then what's going to happen is this. You're going to show up here. You're going to say, well, Pastor, I've been a member of Ephesians for 25 years. How come I can't come sit in the sanctuary? Well, because you didn't do what we just told you to. We need you to go to embcmilwaukee.org, click where it says in-person service, and fill in your name, the name of your child, the name of your friends who are coming to service with you to help us to make sure that we have a seat set aside for you. Now, listen, this is not to say if you show up here that we will not allow for you to come in to worship, because we don't want to turn away people. But what we will do is once the sanctuary is filled to the capacity that we're limited to, and we will stick to that number, I don't care who you are. Hopefully you hear this and hear my heart with this. Our ushers are going to stick to the number that we got in here. We will move you to the overflow space, which will be the learning center. You'll still be in the sanctuary. You're going to hear the music just as good, the preaching just as well as you would being in the learning center. And then also what this will help us do too is it will help us understand what additional steps we need to do to accommodate everyone, because we don't want to turn away anyone. I want to say one other really quick thing before we move on from this is that those of you who are watching and you have underlying health conditions, we want to encourage you to stay at home. I want you to know if I don't see your face here, I don't want you to feel guilty. This is just a different time. And also I want to say this to you. Hear me closely. I know there are many of you all who are eager to get back into God's house, and I'm eager to see you. However, if you are not feeling 100% your best, stay at home. Because when you get here, we're going to ask you if you have not been feeling well. And don't be selfish. We're still going to be streaming service. If you got friends that are coming, let them still come anyways. As you feel better, come back. And we will worship together in person. And I want to say also to help preface this that the sanctuary will be open as early as 10 a.m. for you to be able to come to pray. There are some of us that we know there's just a peace that we just need to give it to God, just being in this holy and sacred space. And so we want to encourage those of you who are going to be coming to worship with us in person next week. Hear me closely. Don't show up here at 11 o'clock, because then you're going to be upset. You got to stand in the line to get in the building. Plan to be here at 10. That way it gives you time, because we need to make sure we got the right phone number for you, the right address for you. We need to make sure that this is going to be a new process for everyone. If you don't have a mask, we need to get you a mask. We're taking everyone's temperature. It's going to take a little bit longer of a little bit of time to get you in. And also, let me say this to you really quickly. I know that for those of you who are guests that are watching this, I'm doing this because I want to make sure that everyone understands really clearly. When you come here to worship, you may have been accustomed to sitting in the back. We ain't doing that. When you walk in the building, where the ushers take you to, that's where you're sitting at. You got a problem with it, you can go back home, or you can go over to the learning center. You can go back home because we ain't doing that. But when you get here, we need you to follow the instructions of the ushers. You walk in here and they take you up front, that's where you're going to sit. And we need you to sit in the seat that they put you in, because it's for the safety of everyone who is here. And masks are required. So thank you all so much. I needed to clear that up so we can make sure that everyone understands how we're going to be moving forward. At this time, we want to go ahead and prepare to give to the Lord the tithe and the offering. And God has been so good to us. He has been so, so good to us. And I don't know about you, but I am amazed at the goodness of God. I am literally speechless to see how God has been keeping his people through a pandemic, through civil unrest, through jobs closing down, through schools shutting down, daycares closed, and God's still been keeping us. And you know, I done did all of this for you, and you'll be so stingy with your time. There's some of you all right now, when I said let's go to Garden Homes Park to help us go serve the community, you say, well, preacher, I ain't coming out there. But you'll run up in the Kohl's department store or the Gap, go to Pick and Save 5 and 6 times in a day, be in there with hundreds of people, pull up in the parking lot, Lauren, and forget you left your mask at home and say, you know what, I'm going to brave this one out and I'm going to go in there anyways because I need to get this chicken to cook for dinner tonight. And then get back home, park your car, and forget you forgot to get your oil to even fry your chicken. You drive right back and go in there with no mask on. And how disturbing it must be to our God that his people will not even return back to him the little bit he asked for us to give back to him to make sure that his church has what it needs to do the work. And if you're watching with us, I just challenge you. Just Google Ephesians Missionary Baptist Church and put news. You're going to see we do the work of serving the people in this community. And let me say this, and we're going to go ahead and give. I say this not to offend, but I say this to show you the ignorance that some people have of the work we've been doing in this community for the 36 years we've been here. A few days ago, I was over, and I'm grateful to God when some of you all get back here to be, and we can go take a walk and see the new piece of property we purchased across the street. And some of the members that were here yesterday that were cleaning up, we walked over there, and a few of us were like, Lord Jesus, we own all of this? And I'm like, yep, from that fence all the way to the next fence. And for those of you who cut grass with push mowers, just come take a look and figure out about how long it takes to push the lawnmower to cut all that grass over there. Long story short, this young man walked up to me and another man from our church as we're looking at the landscape and the things that we need to do. And he started running his mouth about how could that church be over there with all that space over there? And it seems like y'all don't do nothing in the community. I said, well, hold on, man. I don't know where you got your news from. And he told me he was from out of state. And I said to him, I said, well, man, listen, somebody's been giving you the wrong information. And as I started running off the list of things that we just done in the last 12 months, you could see how his mouth just started shutting closed more and more and more and more. And I say that not to brag, but to say, if we could do all of that with that little bit of money, what if everybody else got on board and started tithing and giving to the Lord? The tithe and the offering. I don't want to beat a dead horse, but we feed the hungry. We provide housing for those that are homeless. And as God keeps putting things in front of us, we're going to continue to keep doing the work to help to meet the needs of people who are across our city. But we need your help in order to do that. Listen, I'm going to say this again. I know many of you all have already heard this scripture, but I want you to think about this. Malachi chapter 3 says, God says, bring to the storehouse the tithe and offering. You heard, I said it right. The tithe and offering. Not the offering and not the tithe. But the tithe and an offering. And what blows my mind with this, and we're going to go ahead and pray over the offering and give it, that God says, if you bring to me the tithe and offering, that means the tithe and offering from the paycheck you got from the 40 hours a week, from the rent you collected from your tenants in the month, from your Social Security check that you got, from the pension that you got, from the dividends that pay from the stock returns that you have. He says, from every single resource that I put in your hands, a tithe and the offering needs to come back to the Lord's house. Now, I know we got a lot of people in here that invest, that are watching, but this is what the Lord says. He says, try me in this. If I don't open the windows to push out a blessing. I know you're thinking in your mind, how big does the blessing gotta be that you gotta open windows, plural, to push out one blessing? I say, try the Lord. Put God to the test and don't see if he doesn't show himself faithful. Listen, if you're prepared to give, I'm going to invite you to visit embcmilwaukee.org to give and also download the Givelify app, as well as you can mail your offering, tithes and offering, to 2412 North 6th Street to the Ephesians Missionary Baptist Church, Milwaukee, Wisconsin, 53212, to give to the Lord. I want to ask you, to grab your offering envelope or device, and let's hold it high. Let's ask the Lord to bless our gifts. Father in heaven, thank you now for the privilege of being able to give to you what you so graciously have given to us. God, we thank you, we thank you, we thank you, Lord God. Father, there are many people that are a part of the Ephesians family, and those that are watching, we have not gone hungry, not one day. And it is only because of your kindness and your mercy. It's only because of your provision. And God, we ask you now, be pleased with what we give back to you. Ask you now, Lord God, that you would have mercy on the person who had it to give and they spent it. I ask you now, Lord God, that those of us that are giving to you, but we're giving sparingly, convict our hearts to give generously. And I ask you now, Lord God, that you would give us wisdom and knowledge and understanding how to be a good steward with all that you have entrusted to us. God, continue to bless us with favor. God, I'm so grateful and I'm so thankful that when we trust you with the finances, what we thought we needed to get the job done, you find a way to bless us with favor that what we thought we needed to spend to acquire, you bless us with favor that it cost us less than it would have cost others. And God, all we can do is just give you glory and give you thanks as we give this little bit back to you. We thank you for your faithfulness and your kindness. We thank you for your provision, Lord God. We thank you for your hands being upon us, that it's been your hand that has kept us safe. It's not about us wearing these masks and washing our hands. But if your hand is not upon us, we're exposed to all that the devil wants to do to us. So we thank you now. Bless these gifts. Return it back to your people. Some 30, some 60, some 100-fold according to their gifts. We thank you for you doing all these things in your son Jesus' name. Amen. Amazing. No one compares to you, Lord Jesus. Would you say this in your home? No one compares to you. No one compares to you, Lord God, because you are amazing. I'm just praying we have the right kind of church one day, that even though it may seem foolish to everyone else, I know that my affections are going to the one who sits high and who looks low. And even if my neighbors may think I'm out of my mind, that who is he over there talking to? That even though I live by myself, that God, you're still amazing. No one compares to you.
No one compares to you.
No. Listen, if you're in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, let me give you some evidence that no one compares to you. All over the world, the COVID cases have been going up. number of hospitalizations have been going up all over the country. But can you believe it, whether or not that right here in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, the number of cases have been going down? The number of hospitalizations have been going down? And it ain't that we so good and the people down south are so bad. But God is so amazing that when the evil one wanted to come in and destroy us, God said, not so. Thank you, Lord Jesus. No one compares to you. No one compares to you. No one compares to you, Lord Jesus. Sing this with them. No one compares to you. Not my mother, not my father. Not my boyfriend, not my girlfriend, not my husband, not my children. They disappointed me. My husband don't have all the money to take care of me and every single need. My job, they let me go. I thought I could count on them. But no one compares to you. Yes, Lord Jesus. Because you're so amazing. You're amazing. Sing this with them. You're amazing. You're amazing. That's all they're saying. You're amazing. I don't have the words, God, but you're just amazing. You are amazing. My refrigerator is proof that you're amazing. My gas hand on my car is proof that you're amazing. Yes, Lord Jesus. You're amazing. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You're amazing. Thank you, Lord God. My heart is overjoyed. I feel like one of those old church mothers and deacons. When I look back over my life and I see how good God has been, I feel indebted that I don't have the words or the means to say, God, thank you for you being so good to me. Forget all the material stuff, but God, thank you for being so good. Yes, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. You are so worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Tears are not of joy are not because I got a new car or a new house. I just think back on how good God has been to me, that he's kept me from danger seen and unseen, that he kept food on my table when I didn't deserve it, he kept a roof over my head when I didn't deserve it, and he kept me in good health and kept my mind functioning. And for that, God, I just thank you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Y'all go ahead. I ain't gonna stop you. Go ahead. Would you just give God the best praise you got? If your neighbors hear you picking them up and putting them down, say, blame it on God, because he's been just that good to me. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We'll be right back. sorry, y'all. I feel like this is a little bit of testimony time. You know, last week I had a chance to minister to some men. Last week, you good. And as I was ministering to those men, thank you so much. As I was ministering to those men, and I heard one man say, I was locked away for 13 years. And another man said, man, I was locked behind bars for 20 years. And then another man said, I was locked away for 30 years. And as I sat there, I said, I'm no different than they are. All it was I didn't get caught. But it's because of God's grace and mercy that the redeemed of the Lord ought to say, God, thank you. That it should have been me. It should have been me. But God, thank you. Sing this with them. I am redeemed. I am redeemed. Bought with the price.
Bought with the price.
Jesus has changed.
Jesus
has changed
has
my whole
changed
life.
My whole life.
And listen, when they start asking you, who are you? Say, I am redeemed.
Tell them I am redeemed.
I am redeemed. I am redeemed. Yes, Lord, I am redeemed.
Tell
them that
I am redeemed.
If you know you're redeemed, would you, the redeemed of the Lord, say so? Would you put your hands together? Would you open up your mouth? Would you speak well of your God? Would you give him praise,
just for him being who he is. Would you give him praise that his son gave his life over 2,000 years ago for a sinner just like you? God, we thank you. We thank you when we praise you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You know, Miss Todd, I believe there were some deacons that when they used to stand up front to pray, they say, Father, here I am coming to you with bowed down heads and humble hearts. Because you know when you serve a God who sits high and looks low, your pride needs to leave and go out the back door, but you recognize I come humble because I don't deserve for you to listen to not even a word that I got to say. But thank you that I am counted in that number of being redeemed. We thank and praise our great God for his faithfulness. Y'all forgive me now. I'm trying to move on. I really am. But I was looking at Instagram this morning, and I saw a picture of Pastor Brian Carter. He pastors the Concord Church down in Dallas, Texas. And he succeeded a giant of a preacher. His name was the Reverend E.K. Bailey. And E.K. Bailey had started getting sick, and he was unsure of who it was that needed to succeed him. He wrestled with it. He thought it was someone he was supposed to groom that was already there. And when I looked at the picture, I saw Brian Carter standing next to E.K. Bailey while he was in his wheelchair. And I couldn't stop crying as I looked at that picture because it reminded me of me standing next to Reverend Joe Todd. That God in all his providence would choose a little person like me. I don't stand here as if I got the perfect resume or I deserve to be leading such a fantastic church, but I'm honored and thankful that God would do such a thing. I challenge you to look back over your own life and you see and recognize how good God has been to you. That we don't deserve what the Lord has done for us, but we're grateful and we're thankful. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for you being holy. Thank you, Lord. I'm going to ask you, if you would, to grab your copy of God's word and meet us in Nehemiah. Chapter 4, verses 1 through 8. Before we even read God's word, would you sing this song with us? That some of us just holy, keep playing, Brother Jermaine, holy, 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 holy. Persons. One more time. God in three persons.
God in three persons.
Blessed Trinity.
Blessed Trinity.
Amen. Grab your copy of God's word and meet us in Nehemiah chapter 1. As we continue in our series of rebuilding our city, this week we land at Nehemiah chapter 4. We're going to be reading verses 1 through 8. And we're going to be reading from the New American Standard Bible. And
My Bible reads as such. It says, "Now it came about that when Sanballat heard that we were rebuilding the wall," Lord Jesus, "he became furious and very angry and mocked the Jews. He spoke in the presence of his brothers and the wealthy men of Samaria and said, 'What are these feeble Jews doing? Are they going to restore it for themselves? Can they offer sacrifices? Can they finish in a day? Can they revive the stones from the dusty rubble, even the burnt ones?' Now Tobiah the Ammonite was near him, and he said, 'Even what they are building, if a fox should jump on it, he would break their stone wall down. Hear, O our God, how we are despised. Return their reproach on their own heads and give them up for plunder in a land of captivity. Do not forgive their iniquity, and let not their sin be blotted out before you, for they have demoralized the builders.'" Lord Jesus. "So we built the wall, and the whole wall was joined together to half its height, for the people had a mind to work. Now when Sanballat, Tobiah, the Arabs, the Ammonites, the Ashdodites heard that the repair of the walls of Jerusalem went on, and that the breaches began to be closed, they were very angry. All of them conspired together to come and fight against Jerusalem and to cause a disturbance in it." Listen, for the time that you and I have together this morning, I like to title this text in our exchange just simply, "Work with what you have." Work with what you have. I ask you to bow your heads with me in a word of prayer. Our Father and our God, we thank you for your faithfulness, your kindness, your mercy towards us. And God, we just thank you for just the beauty of memory. God, we thank you for the beauty and the splendor of the brain, that you have made it in such a magnificent way that you allow for us to recall events, the emotions, the feelings, the smell, the sight, the touch of the great things that you have done in our lives. And God, we thank you for them. Lord, we ask you now this morning that you would speak to us. And we say, "Speak, Lord, for your servants are listening." God, we ask you now that you would revive us, Lord God, as there are many of us who have become discouraged and encourage someone and uplift someone. We thank you for you doing these mighty and magnificent things for your glory and our good. In your son Jesus' name, amen. Thomas L. Jennings, Mark E. Dean, Madam C.J. Walker, and the Dr. Charles Richard Drew are just a few of the names of magnificent African-American inventors. These men and women are the definition of having your back against the wall. They show you and I, through their ingenuity, through their perseverance, and their hard work, that you and I should not get consumed in the things that we currently possess or our limitations with the resources that we have in front of us. But as we're going to learn today, that if you and I would just take what we already have in our hands and connect with the Lord Jesus Christ, that there's nothing that's impossible that we can't do.
This morning, we get a chance to see, as we continue making our way through the book of Nehemiah, that we come across these Jewish individuals who are returning back from exile after being removed from the promised land for 70 years. They have gone through colonialization of two of history's greatest empires. It was the Babylonians who were the ones that removed them from Jerusalem. And occupying their land and controlling them. That we began to see that in the midst of them returning back to their city, they see it burnt in ashes. They see the walls have been destroyed, that commerce is not in place, that the schools are destroyed, that the family structure has completely eroded. And upon their return, the people are there for a significant amount of time. But the change that needed to happen had not taken place. But then God, by his providence, allows the problems, the challenges of Jerusalem to hit the ears of one man. Oh, let me say this to you, dear brothers and sisters, that God, all he needs is just one. Sometimes we get ourselves consumed in having buy-in from hundreds of people and tens of people, but God says, all I need is just one man, one woman to stand up to the plate and answer the call that I have on their lives. And we've been learning that this person who's been called, who responds to the call, is this man, Nehemiah. And when he gets there, he begins to organize the people in such a way that they begin rebuilding the wall from house to house. And as they begin the work, my dear brothers and sisters, they teach you and I that when you begin to do the work and begin to work with what you have, the first thing it shows you and I is that as you begin the work, expect to have enemies. I know that's something that some of you Christians didn't want to hear, but soon as you start having progress in your life, I'm just looking for a few witnesses. I'm glad for the ones we got in the sanctuary, the few that are here, because those few amens, they just pushed me on to just go. Who are stabbing you right in your back. And some of you all may be saying, well, preacher, why is it that I should expect to have enemies? Because the Bible says so. Psalm chapter 2 verses 1 through 4 says, why are the nations in an uproar and the peoples devising a vain thing? The kings of the earth take their stand and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and his anointed. Let us tear their fetters apart and cast away their cords from us. And he who sits in heaven laughs, the Lord scoffs at them. Nehemiah shows you and I that when you and I find out that we got some enemies that we didn't know about, don't become worried. Don't become scared. Remember that your God who sits high and looks low, he scoffs at them. See, the problem that so many believers begin to fall apart when they recognize they got some haters, some enemies, some people who plotting, some folks who want to watch you fail, some people who are plotting your demise, is that we fall into the trap of what their plans are instead of forgetting about the God who's got our back. Nehemiah and these Jews who return to Jerusalem, they recognize that the work that they have been doing is all God's work. See, you become fearful when you know you're doing something that's not God's work. But when you're doing God's work, you got to remind yourself that if God be for us, who in all the devils in hell can be against us? And so we see that Brother Nehemiah, that as he unites the church together, it is their strength, It is the safety that they provide together. Listen, I'm going to say this because there's a few of you all out there I know you're watching right now. You're going to be listening to this on the radio. You think that because the church couldn't gather in the building, that you can live as a Christian by yourself. But Nehemiah and the Jews in Jerusalem show you and I that while they were doing it by themselves, they were vulnerable, they were weak, they were insignificant. But the moment they started coming together, what the enemy thought he could do by picking off one, he couldn't do because there was about five or six of his brothers that was right next to him. Oh, I'm coming for you. When you united with the local church, when you think you in it by yourself, when you don't have the mind to pray, there's some people who are interceding for you just because your name is on the roll. And look and see what happens. As soon as they started doing the work of rebuilding the walls in Jerusalem, they started having enemies. They started having enemies that not only started planning their demise, they got so upset that they became furious and angry. Don't that sound a little bit like what some of us are experiencing? You got folks who will talk about you on social media as they see your business get off the ground. What is this nigga think he's doing? All he got is a lawnmower walking down, cutting a few people's lawns, and they thinking they're going to mean much of that. No, yeah, that's what you think. Just keep on watching. Because as I stack up the contract I make from this one house, plus that house, plus that house, plus this customer who you thought was paying for a $10 service, but when I got 100 of them that's paying that $10 service every single once a month, and when I start getting subscribers, Sister Sheena, who paying for membership once a month, and they might be paying me $20 a month, but when you add them up, when you multiply that by 500 or 1,000, what you thought was little and insignificant, that as I began to build one brick after another, after another, after another, what you thought wasn't going to happen, you begin to see it materialize in front of your eyes, that when people see the realization of the vision. Oh, listen here, child of God. There's a few of you all out there right now that you was angry with me beforehand because whatever it is that you thought. But wait until you see the vision become fully realized and tangible and touchable, and that you can smell it and touch it and hug it. You really gonna hate me then. Because we see that as soon as you begin the work for God, you're going to always have enemies. And that what you and I have to understand is that our enemies are only concerned about you and I not succeeding. But Nehemiah shows you and I something. That not only can you dwell and become comfortable that you're going to have enemies, but he says that in you and I working with what we have, your response to the demoralizing criticism should be prayer and productive action. Look at this with me in verses 4 through 6. When Nehemiah started hearing the words that they were saying, look at what he says. Sanballat, one of their enemies, got within earshot of them. He says, what are these feeble Jews doing? Are they going to restore it for themselves? Can they offer sacrifices? Can they finish in a day? Can they revive the stones from the dusty rubble, even the burnt ones? And it sounds a little bit like some of the folks who will be saying to you, who do they think they are? It takes a degree to get to that level. You can't become successful on that level in Milwaukee. Who does that preacher think he's in? He's only been pastoring that church for 2 years. He ain't got the juice or the connections or the size of the congregation to do that kind of work. And Nehemiah shows you and I that guess what?
it's okay if their words hit your ears, but don't let their words destroy you. Let their words be served or be used as fuel to cause you to pray and put productive action behind it. Nehemiah says this in verses 4 through 6. He says, "Hear, O our God, how we are despised. Return their reproach on their own heads and give them up for plunder in a land of captivity. Do not forgive their iniquity, and let not their sin be blotted out before you, for they have demoralized the builders." Nehemiah shows you and I that Bible-believing prayer will result in supernatural productivity. See, the problem is some of you all have been trying to get the work done to try to show other folks up, but trying to do it in your own strength. But Nehemiah shows you and I that when you get word from the evil one about his plans, about his schemes, about the messages that he's been sending to try to demoralize you, okay, let me come down your street. Your ex-boyfriend, your former husband heard about what you was planning to do. And last time they saw you, they said, "You ain't gonna never be nothing, because when I was with you, you wasn't nothing anyway." And you really let that get to your ears, and it really started to mess with your emotions a little bit. It even started to throw you off your square a little bit. And then when you started talking with a few of your homeboys who they've been doing a little bit better, but then your mind starts to flip to say, "You know what? I'm really grateful that job laid me off, because it really showed me really how much hustle I really got down on the inside of my soul. That I didn't think that it was really this much money that was out here like this, but God's been opening my eyes, even giving me some new lenses to see the opportunity that's out there. I thought I needed to have a marketing firm and a PR person and a salesperson, but God showed me that me plus him is more than enough." And Nehemiah says that you can't just go out there and do the work to prove those folks wrong. But you got to understand that I need supernatural help to get the job done. Because this group of Jews, they made prayer a priority and not discussion. See, there's too many of us that's watching on social media right now. Soon as we hear our enemies talking about us, we go to social media trying to tell everybody about what people think of us. And God says that ain't the way. Because see, the moment you start talking about what they told you, you're amplifying their ability more than you are the God who can help you overcome the plots and schemes of the evil one. And so Nehemiah says to you and I, jot this down. Make sure you tweet this. Don't waste your time responding to your enemies. Take your concerns to the Lord. I think I know what this is, and I thank you, Holy Spirit, that I'm talking to some Christians who are so immature that your way is to try to show people that you ain't no punk by trying to rattle your mouth off, go fight them in the street, drive up to their house, cut their tires, talk about their businesses so they don't move ahead, start writing bad reviews on Google and all these other places to try to see them fail and all this other kind of stuff. And God says to you and I, don't waste none of your energy on them niggas. I got to say it to you so you can get it where I'm coming from. My white brothers and sisters, I can use that N-word. It really shouldn't be used, but don't you dare ever use that in public. Don't use it in private, okay? But Nehemiah says to you and I, don't waste your time on them. Because the more time and energy you waste in dealing with the people who don't like you, who want to see you fail, who want to see you not succeed, guess what you're doing? You giving over in your mind the time and energy that guess what will happen? You will fail. You will fall
fall into their trap. You will think that I'll always be a borrower and not a lender. That I'm going to always be last and never be first. But you got to surround yourself with some believers and say, no, that's the wrong kind of thinking. I am the first and not the last. I am above only and never beneath. I will be the lender and not the borrower. I've been borrowing all my life. I got some credit that's out there, a few bills I got to pay. But guess what? There's going to come a day before my eyes get shut and I go on to glory that I'm going to be the lender and not the borrower. See, here's the problem that we got to start making sure that we stay connected with the right group of people who are walking with God. Because maybe there's a few of you all who've already heard this saying already, that an idle mind is what? The devil's workshop. See, when Satan can get you by yourself, he can get you to start believing a little bit of anything and everything. But when you get with other believers, they say, no. We ain't talking like that around here. Listen, you know what? Here is a thing that I want to see our church, the Ephesians Missionary Baptist Church, begin to flip. That when we got the body of Christ working together, looking out for each other, challenging each other, and I'm going to say this to you right now before you even get back in the building. Listen, if you ain't with being held accountable, this ain't the place for you. Because we about seeing each other elevate, not stay where we at. We've been living down here far too long that we recognize God got more for us to be up here than to settle down here. If I've been living like this all my little life, I've been getting gray hairs, pulling my hair out, worried and stressed out. I don't want my kids to experience that. But as we go, we're going to go together. I'm grabbing you by the arm. I'm going to hold you accountable. Because you know what's one of the things that really bothers me? We're going to move on from here. That so often what you see in the black church, the only person prospering is the pastor. What if some folks pulled up here at EMBC and they said, man, I don't know what car is the pastor's because everybody over there ride nice. I don't know. Man, is the whole church living like that? Everybody got their own stuff? And God says that the way that happens is when the church comes together and holds itself accountable. And so look at what happens. You and I have to keep in mind that our enemies, their whole sole purpose is to discourage and to disrupt productivity. It's to discourage and to disrupt the productivity. Satan, I serve you notice right now in the name of Jesus because I'm going to expose you right now. See, this is how you know that there are some folks that even though they make their way in here, they're going to register and get a seat in here. They're going to be here early. They are people that are being used by the evil one because they come in to disrupt and slow down productivity. Okay, let me give you some insight to those individuals. They're the ones that are leaning over your ear and say, you know, I don't know who she thinks she is. Don't you know that pastor up there, all he's trying to do is trick us out of this and trick us out of that? Who does he think we are that he think we got all this money to be able to give every time somebody got a need? He always coming to us to be able to ask us for some more money. All that man want to do is to build a nice life for himself. Well, let me just let you in on a little something. Y'all don't really pay me that much anyway. Ain't nothing to take because all of it got to be spent to just make sure stuff are taken care of around here. And then make sure that when you do come with a need, you come and ask and we make sure that you got it. But listen to what Nehemiah and these other Jews did. They had to have their minds made up, hear me closely now, about why you gotta work with what you have. They had their minds made up, I can't give in to what they tempted me to do. Listen, you gotta work with what you have because you gotta remember, why did you start the work in the first place? to come in and remind the men, brothers, don't you see how the whole city is in array and disarray? Can you see our kids don't even have a school to learn in to get a good education because the school is destroyed and crumbled? Can you see we don't have a place for us to be able to hear the word of God be clearly explained and proclaimed? We don't have a place for us to be able to gather together to be able to pray. We don't have a place for us to be able to gather together and be encouraged by one another. And he had to show them because they couldn't see it. That's why I want to say to you, my dear brother, my sister, stop discounting the preacher, because God's got a way of using him in such a way that even though your eyes got scales over them and you can't really see how bad the situation that you're in, God has a way of softening your heart and removing the scales that as the preacher begins to speak, you see that your life is in complete chaos. And when he says this to them, these men and women, they don't just accept the report of their enemies. They say, I got too much at stake for me to give up now. Listen, I'm talking to the wrong kind of church, because we need a church that believes and say, guess what? I'm working as hard as I am right now because my children deserve a better life than this. Listen, it might be some black men that have been killed around this city, but I want to make sure that ain't another black life being taken. Guess what? I want to make sure that if my life is a struggle right now, I want to make sure that the next business owner that comes along, they get equal fair shake in every single sphere of influence and business that they get involved in, because they say it's too much at stake to give up now. It's too much at stake to give up. I want to show you this for a moment. Media room, if you could show them this picture. This picture that you're looking at here, this is the Great Wall of China. You see how nicely neat and put together the bricks are? They're all about the same size as they're put together, stacked one on top of the other. It makes the work real easy to do, to build a wall when all the bricks are evenly smooth, all square, and built exactly the same. But what we see, you go to that next picture. Here is a picture of the wall that Nehemiah built. The wall Nehemiah built, some bricks were square because they were left over from the rubble from the fire that was made to destroy Jerusalem. But as they began to look around, there were some bricks that were broken up and crumbled. And they had their mind made up because they couldn't go nowhere to go buy bricks. And they said that my family is too important. That even though it looks like this can't be much of nothing, I got to work with what I have. Listen, Lord Jesus, if I could just get the right kind of church to be on board to accept the report that the preacher's giving to you right now, you may not have all the tools that you think you need to have right now. You may have and not have all the support of your family, of your wife, of your husband, of your kids. They may call you a failure, and they're trying to speak death into your life and saying to you, you'll never amount to nothing. Who do you think you are? You need to keep pushing that broom. And you need to, and you saying to your mind, yep, I'm going to keep pushing that broom, but this broom is going to turn into a business that's going to provide for me and my family. And your mind is made up like the Jews in Jerusalem that I can make this work. It might take a little bit of time. This rock might not be all the way smooth like it needs to be, but I'm going to take this round rock and put it on this square flat surface. And I'm going to find a way that if I got to put more grout on top of it to smooth it out and wrap it all the way around itself, I'm going to take the next brick and put that brick on top of that one. And if it takes me longer than it normally would have, I'm going to find a way to chisel that next brick out to make it smooth so I can put another brick on top of it. You don't hear what I'm saying? See, people who don't have all the resources that everybody else has, let me let you in on the news flash. It's going to take you more work to get the work done because you're doing more with less. And these men and women, rather than looking at the situation in front of them, they say, man, we don't care about that. We got to make it happen. What if we had people who were part of God's church that instead of complaining said, come hell or high water, we're going to get this job done? What if there were some of us who said, man, I see my community's all messed up, but I ain't got no answer. But I'm going to take what I have and I'm going to do my little bit to be an agent of change. What if there were some of us who said, you know what, man, I've been hearing about black businesses not being able to compete with our white brothers and sisters because they don't have the buying power. They don't have the shelf space let me explain this to you. They don't get any shelf space in some of the major retailers to be able to compete with their white counterparts or Chinese counterparts. And so what I'm going to do is the least I can do with what I have is at least go spend $5 or $6 extra dollars for shea butter with the black man than going to Walmart and buying his stuff because it's cheaper. Instead of me looking for the place to get my feminine products that I need and looking on Groupon because all I want to do is save a few dollars, the least I could do is go spend my money with Sheena. She my sister in Christ, that I could see her get up and see her business explode. And dare I say, when I recognize that I need counseling services and I know that it costs something for me to sit with somebody to help me figure out how to navigate to get this messy life of mine together, that I don't go to my sister in Christ and say, well, sister, look, you know, all I really got is like $20. Like, could you help me out with that? No. I say, you know what? Instead of me going to get the lace wig and getting my hair pressed and going to get them new nails that you're going to chip and break anyway, I put my little money together. I go outside, pick up cans if I have to. I get my cell phone turned off to get my hair right. And I come to my sister in Christ and I come to her correct to pay her for her service, because that's what the cost is. And Nehemiah says that, look, when you get the word from your enemies, you have to commit and connect yourself to prayer and productive action. Now, see, I had to say this one more time before we push on here. Because there's too many of us that are, all we're doing is settling for complaints instead of putting some action behind it. How long you been talking about the same thing and ain't put no action behind it? How long you been complaining about renting from somebody and you say you want your own house? When you going to start saving? You can't blame me or say that this church don't teach you about. I mean, every year since I've been here, we've been taking time out in October and November. Every single week, you see an image that say up there, if you got a problem with a brother or sister, hold off on giving your offering. Give to God the tithe and offering first. You've heard me say numerous times that after you give to God the tithe and offering, pay yourself. That don't mean go on a trip. That don't mean go buy a new shirt. That don't mean go buy a new car. That means put some money up for a rainy day. And let me say this again. If you don't got $1,000 in the bank, you all the way messed up. Because soon as something happened, you're going to take your bill money to get out the jam. And dare I say to those of you who are out there right now, dare I say to you, don't think for one moment you're going to come to this church and I know you've been working and you show us a paycheck stub and asking us to bail you out of not paying your utility bill for 3 and 4 months, God have mercy on your soul. You need to go find someplace else to come help bail you out, because we ain't doing it. Because I done said over and over again, be a good steward, but you done went and bought TVs. You done went and bought new clothes. You done went and bought new Jordans. You done bought all this other foolishness instead of handling business like you're supposed to. By the way, July 25th is the day the moratorium is. I'm just trying to give you a heads up notice about it. But look at this with me, verses 7 through 8. Verses 7 through 8 says to you and I that as the work begins to materialize, expect to have new enemies. You don't hear what I'm saying. Nehemiah and these Jews, as they went through this rebuilding process, they did the work of taking stones that in most cases really shouldn't be used to rebuild a building or a wall. And I don't know if it's those of you who are not familiar that a wall needs to be secure to keep enemies from coming in. And these men and women made up their mind that as they were building, they took their time to make sure that each level that they went to, Lord Jesus, was secure enough that as they put another brick on top, what was beneath wouldn't fall. See, the problem with some of you all, you want to get to the top, but you ain't making sure that as you get to the top, the stuff underneath ain't secure. Listen, you want the successful business that's thriving and booming and succeeding, but you won't even stick to a budget in your own house. Let me move on from there. So what happened is this, Nehemiah, when they build the wall, they didn't even build it to its completion. They only built it to half its original height. I'm pretty sure there's a few of you all out there right now that's saying, Pastor, I can completely understand how Brother Nehemiah felt. It felt like I had some people that I knew on the front end were enemies to start out because they told me they didn't like me. But it seemed like as soon as I got halfway to my goal, there were some new people that I didn't even expect started showing up that didn't even like me. If you look at this on the map, when we started out at Nehemiah chapter 1, there was only two people that they had that didn't like them. It was Tobiah and Sanballat. But the Bible says that when they built the wall halfway to its original height, then Sanballat in verse 7, Tobiah, the Arabs, the Ammonites, the Ashites, they all went in on with themselves together and they all became very angry. When you look at this on the map, what it shows you and I is that when they got to half its height, Jerusalem had enemies that were completely surrounding it all the way around, all the people who were around them. And you know what they began to discover that I want to tell some of you all that are out there right now? Because you thought when you gave your life to Jesus Christ, all your enemies were just going to go away. And I want to apologize to you on behalf of the preacher who told you, reach up and pull it down and spin around and your haters ain't going to be no more. And come sow a $100 seed and God's going to destroy all your enemies and all this other kind of foolishness. I want to say to you, you have been duped. Because when you walk with God, he says that I prepare a table for you in the presence of your enemies. That means God can't destroy their eye sockets and make them blind. Because he got to make sure that some of your enemies got to have 20/20 vision, baby. They got to get rid of they got to get cataract surgery to see what God's going to do in your life. He's got to fix their hearing for them to hear about people talking about how blessed you are and how your business is growing up and how you married now. You were single for a long time, but guess what? That tall, dark, and handsome, or that short, roly-poly man or woman happened to blow themselves right into your life, and God says, I got to let them see it all. Listen, I'm talking to the wrong church because I was talking to the right church. You would start giving God praise now that even though I can't see it, even though I can't touch it, God got some stuff that he's got that's on the way. But you know what blows my mind? About why we need the right kind of church that believes in Bible believing prayer. And I want to say to those of you out there right now, because there's a few of you all that I know, God speaks to me about the foolishness you say behind the walls. There's a few of you all who are on the prayer line and you say, well, brother pastor, I ain't getting on the prayer line because y'all spend all that time reading God's word first before you pray. Because what we're trying to do is follow the word of God to fuel us in our prayers. See, Bible-believing prayer does this for you and I. It causes you and I to stand on God's actual promises instead of Christian jargon. See, because Brother Nehemiah, this is what he had in his mind. As he began to pray God's word from Nehemiah chapter 2 and verse 4, he said, "Hear, O God, how we are despised, return their reproach on their own heads, and give them up in plunder in a land of captivity." Because see, some of you all think that's a real foul prayer for Christians to pray. But Nehemiah shows you and I that, listen, you and I get to pray those types of bold prayers. Because if God says vengeance is his, well, God, guess what? You don't want me to lay hands on them. I got the recipe for you that about how I want you to handle your people who've been messing with your children. God put them out of their reproach. And because I know you raised me up to a place now, I don't want you to break their legs. I don't want you to let their car get on flat. What I want you to do is don't forgive their iniquity. And let not their sin be blotted out before you. For they have demoralized the builders. What if we had a church that prayed them kind of prayers? That the moment you out in the grocery store, you hear somebody talking about the pastor of Ephesians Missionary Baptist Church, you say, no, not my pastor. I know you didn't just say Reverend Raymond C. Monk. Don't even let Ephesians Missionary Baptist Church come out of your mouth even crooked. Because guess what? I ain't got to find you in the parking lot. All I got to do is slide over into my prayer closet. And God forbid, give me about 15, 20 minutes of talking to my God. That I know my God can do more in a few minutes of prayer than I ever could if I put these hands up on you. But here's the thing that I got to give you insight to, and I'm about to be out your way. The reason the enemy got so mad is because he realized he should have killed you a long time ago. See, I'm talking to the wrong kind of church this morning, because if I was talking to the right kind of church, you recognize that if it had not been for the Lord who was on my side, the enemy sure enough should have took me out a long time ago. But there's a few of us that are the redeemed of the Lord that can say, devil, guess what? You had your chance. And since you didn't take the chance to take me out, as God gives me strength in my legs to keep doing the work, as he puts the strength in my hands to keep doing the work, I'm going to keep on doing the work of the Lord. Because they couldn't fall into the trap. Because I'm telling some of you all right now, the evil one ain't done telling you you ain't going to make it. He's been telling some of you all right now, you ought to kill yourself. He's telling you right now, you ain't pretty. Don't nobody like you. Ain't nobody going to be attracted to you. He's been telling you, guess what? Your last marriage was your last marriage. You'll never be happy. Just keep cutting yourself. Eventually the pain will go away. And Nehemiah says that you got to remind yourself of what God says. That's the reason that some of us are so defeated. That's the reason that we feel we can't go any further. That's the reason why you feel like giving up every single day. Because you've forgotten about the God whom you say you believe in. As we end this time of sharing this morning, what I find to be so amazing is that they were able to get half the wall up quicker than it ever would have been anticipated. But it was so amazing because each of the families had varying interests and even possible oppositions, but they worked together to get the work done, to simply work with what they have. Before we end this time together, would you bow your heads to pray with us this morning? Would you pray and ask God to forgive you right now?
that you've been complaining about what you don't have. And God's been trying to show you what you do have. Would you ask God to forgive you because if somebody else had your opportunities, somebody else had the hand you were dealt, they would accomplish what God's placed in your mind and heart to do. Ephesians, I want you to know that there's so much more God wants us to do, and some of you all have just been settling to say, preacher, this is all I have. All I've ever done was I just been an usher, and that's it. All I did was I just came and sat on a pew, and that was it. All I did was be a hospitality member or work in a security ministry, or I worked in a media ministry, and that's all. All I was just a preacher, and that's it. And God says there's so much more that I want to do with your life. But all I need you to do is just give me 100% control. And then you giving God 100% control, that means you got to believe what he has already said about you. Would you ask God to forgive you? Ask God to forgive you. You looked at your credit score and you felt defeated. And you said, God, how can I do this? When you went to one bank and they rejected you and they said, there's no way in the world we're going to give you the money that you need. You might even be a teenager and you watching this and you saying, man, I'm messed up so much in high school. There's no way in the world I'm ever getting to anybody's college. And God says, I can take the little bit that you got. If you would just connect with me, I can show you how to build with what you have to get you to where you need to go. But I need you just to connect with me. With your head bowed this morning, wherever you are, at home, you're in your kitchen, you're in the living room, you could be watching in the car right now, pull over. If you're not 100% sure that if you were to die today, you would spend eternity in heaven with God. Would you just be honest with yourself right now? Would you raise your hand if you're at home? Say, God, I'm not sure exactly where I would spend eternity. If you raise your hand, would you pray this prayer with me? If you believe that Jesus Christ is God's Son who died on the cross for your sins, pray this prayer with me. Say, dear God, forgive me for the sin that I've done. I recognize that if I were to die today, I'd be on my way to a burning hell. But I recognize you're the one that I need in order for me to get back in right standing with you. I ask you to save me now. I thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, dying on the cross for my sins and that he was buried. And 3 days later, you rose him from the grave. And so since you rose him from the grave, you can raise me up out of the ashes of life. I thank you for you being my savior. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer, if you go ahead and jot that in the comment section on Facebook, or visit our website at embcmilwaukee.org and click on the tab that says become a member, and a member of our team will get back to you to connect with you of what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ. Let's give God praise for the message this morning, the messenger. We discharge our duty, yet there is still room at the cross. We thank God this morning. I want to remind you of this, my brother and my sister. If you're a part of the Ephesians Missionary Baptist Church, be with us for prayer these next 2 days at 6:30 p.m. Meet us tonight at 6:30 p.m. by dialing 414-921-2210. If you missed it, 414-921-2210. You can visit our website and get the phone number and join us for prayer this evening at 6:30. And tomorrow at 6:30, we are fasting as a church from the time we wake up until noon. On the 30th, which is our last day of prayer, I'm going to invite those of you who are willing, and this is if your diet allows for it or your doctor will allow for you to be able to do it, is to fast with us from the time you wake up until 5 p.m. We want to see God do something supernatural in this church. We want to see God do something supernatural in us. And if I can just be very truthful with you, this time of prayer and fasting has been rejuvenating for me. And I know you may be watching this and saying, man, the preacher always seems to have some encouragement to, and it seems like he's always up and never down, but you're not with me when I'm alone by myself. And I'm telling you that the one thing that has kept me from falling apart has been this book and this book only. And it's been my wife who's been by my side, who's been there to be able to encourage me, that she can look me in my face and tell, man, Raymond ain't doing too well today. But as I sit down and I read God's word, as I reflect on it, as I meditate on it, it's like gas going into the gas tank of a car that God sends to lift me up. And I want to encourage you to join us in this time of prayer and fasting as we're looking for God to do great things. As we end this time, I want to remind you, sir or ma'am, don't wait until the weekend to sign up that you come into church. Go to our website right now and sign up right now. If you have to do it four times for you and each one of your kids, I need you to go online and sign up every single one of your kids. Because what's going to happen is this. If you get here and the sanctuary is filled to the capacity that we have, we will put you in the learning center to be able to watch service on Sunday morning. And I'm asking those of you, I'm begging you with a cherry on top. Your cousins and them who not even watching this, they're going to watch it later because they were too lazy. You know how pitiful that is? You're too lazy to watch church at home. And you could be sitting in the bed or sitting on your couch with your pajamas on. You ain't got to put no clothes on. You ain't got to brush your teeth, none of that kind of stuff. And we won't even get up in the morning and do that. And let me say this here, we're going to go here. I heard Dr. Tony Evans say this past week, man, and it was so the truth. And it was a sermon where he was preaching in his church. And he said, for those of you who walked in here just in time for the sermon, you came in here to hear from a man and not hear from God. And I want to say that those of you who tune in at just enough time to hear the preacher or walk in here for service right before the preacher get up, you came in here to hear from a man and not experience God. Because God has a way that in the praise and worship, you and I are experiencing him. He is reviving you. He is encouraging you. But you shortchange God to think that all you need to do is hear from a man and not experience God. Come here next week to experience God. Tune in next week to hear from God and not hear from a man. Listen, we love you all. Visit our website. If you're in a time of hardship, call the church office. I talk to God. Yes, I do. But you know what he's doing? He's breaking down your pride to call the church and tell us that you need help. And let me say this to you right now, and hopefully this will be my last time ever having to say this. I don't operate off of hearsay. If you're sick, I appreciate you telling your Sunday school teacher and Sunday school class. But guess what? The voicemail here works 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. All you got to do is leave a message, and we're going to call and check in on you. And then we're going to get ready to go. Please pray for Sister Jarnetta Maccabee. She's going to be having surgery this week. We pray that surgery goes well and continue to keep Sister Eliza Powell and all of our sick and bereaved in your prayers. Yesterday, she buried her father yesterday. I've never been down that road, but I know it's very challenging and tough. And let's pray for each other. Minister Miriam Smith is caring for her mom. Sister Shirley Williams is caring for her mom also. Let's keep them in our prayers. Let's check on them. Let's find out if they need anything to be there to love on them and to support them. If there's nothing else, may the Lord keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you. May he bless you this week, that you will remember that he is God. May you this week take what you have and work with what you have, doing it for the glory of God. And may you this week discover that you and God is enough, and that's all. Until we get the opportunity to gather together again and to talk with each other by prayer this evening, I love you all. May you all have a great week. Love you. Have a great week. Fellas, thank you all so much. I know y'all normally like to go in, but I'm having them hang around so I can explain to them how we're going to have people come in the building.